ladies and gentlemen, from the Fringe FM. Coming at you live from the middle of nowhere. The center of everywhere here once again to get yet another dose of conversational boogie. This is Shift Happens. Sorry about the false start there. Second week in a row, another glitch that I have never seen happen in all my 5 years of doing this. So, it must be this hotel room I'm staying at. But anyway, we are live now! And, it's all good. We lost a few people. That's alright. As they say, the show must go on. And, the show for you we have indeed tonight. But real quick, let's go ahead and get on with the usuals. Joining us as per usual is our associate producer Brad Harris. You can follow him on Twitter at @ADSBradHarris. What's happening, Brad?
Well, a big hi-ya back at you. And I raise you a soul. So there. Just chilling, man. Stoked for tonight's show. Episode 195. Got Mr. Dank in the house. And we got Russ Bailey in the house. What's up, Russ?
Yeah. What's up, guys? How's it going?
That's so, right. Yeah, we'll be bringing in
the Dank later. And but right now, man, what a crazy week. Some good things going on right now. You know what's going on right now, Gigi? Right this very instant, besides our awesome show?
They just landed that rover on Mars.
Well, that, yes, this is true, but something else. Keep going. Yep, you're right. Conscious Life Expo just started today.
Right. Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. And
so, yeah, go check that out, you guys. Serena and Doug, they couldn't make it. They were sick last week. And unfortunately, we didn't get to get with them this year, but there's always next year. I'm just happy that the show's still going on for them. And go check it out. There's a cool, like, virtual vending area. I was checking it out earlier. You can cruise around and run into people. Saw a couple of heads in there. So what up?
Nice.
And yeah. But yeah, what up with the Mars thing? Man, no problems as far as I know. That's pretty amazing, huh, guys?
Yeah, it's just kind of unfortunate that that news kind of got overshadowed by, you know, Ted Cruz and that situation and every, you know, like, you would think people would care more about what we just did on Mars, but apparently more people are worried about who's taking a vacation or not. So,
right.
I mean, not to say, sure. I mean, he obviously, that was pretty messed up when you did, you know, don't get me wrong, but, man, you know, I think it's time we, you know, check out the positive things that are happening right now, but instead we just keep hearing about these negative things in the news.
Right.
And
right.
But yeah, so so you had to clarify, we do have Russ Bailey here from Beyond the Strange. He's filling in the guest co-host seat of the evening. And so with that said, so what exactly is the mission of that new rover that they landed? What's it there to do?
Soil samples. They're going to do the soil samples and for future colonization of Mars, it appears.
Yeah, they did a new kind of approach this time that was pretty interesting. You know, excuse me, it opened up a capsule, and I believe, you know, the ship was dropped, and then also the landing was different. You know, they used all jets. And then if I'm not mistaken, isn't there a helicopter on board that they're going to take out for a spin to collect some atmosphere data and maybe some terrain or something like that? I'm not really 100% sure.
Yes.
It's pretty interesting. It's all new technology, and it's super, super high-end stuff that we've never tried before. And so far, everything's working great. So hats off to those people over there at NASA and JPL and all the you know, side contractors, too. You know, there's hundreds of them. So it's not just those two. There's, man, thousands of people involved in this stuff. So it's pretty interesting.
Yeah, and I think from what I read, I think they're – the one thing I did read was I think they're looking at a certain crater, and they're trying to discern whether or not there used to be an ancient civilization there or not.
Correct, yeah.
So that'll be interesting to see what they find. But even if they do find anything cool, who knows if they're ever going to tell us about it. Right? So.
Right.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, so, man, that cold front came through. That was pretty gnarly. Texas got hit hard. Dumped a lot of precipitation in there for the first time. And interesting enough, there was some Bigfoot tracks that were recorded through Twitter via Mark from Dallas. Got to check him out. Some Bigfoot tracks in the snow. So they just appeared and disappeared. So, yeah, something for you guys to go check out. And so you getting any of that weather over there, Russ?
Well, we're getting most of the cold front and everything. We had a little bit of icy precipitation last night, just a thin layer. But today it's been just mostly cloudy, a little bit of sun. Hey, I'll take it to Texas, get all the snow. I'm done with snow for the next year or so. I'm really sick of it.
Yeah. What up, Gigi?
And
how you doing?
Still alive. And I'll tell you what, since you know, since we ran a little late here, let's go ahead and cut to the boogie and bring on our guest for tonight. Now, so our guest tonight is Micah Dank. Hails from Long Island. He's an author with a 6-book deal in which he talks about the following topics: gematria, etymology, numerology, astronomy, astrology, astrotheology, OBEs, the Akashic Record, symbology, remote viewing, religious secrets, capstones of the pyramids, mystery school channelers, near-death experiences, and one thing that I'm really interested in is DMT monitoring. More on that in a bit. Lucid dreaming, acoustic levitation physics and quantum physics, psychotherapy, psychology, spiritual guides, and shared dreaming and crystal technology. And that's just to name a few, folks. So I think it's safe to say we have plenty to talk about tonight, and we have many different paths we can go down. And without any further ado, without any further lilly-nilly, ladies and gentlemen, let's give a warm welcome to Mr. Micah Dank. How's it going, Micah?
Hey, how you guys doing? You can hear me all right, right?
Yep, loud and clear, my friend. Loud and clear.
Fantastic.
Sounding good.
Yeah. Are you there?
Yeah. No, I'm here.
All right, good deal, man. So, it's great to have you on the show. You know, we've talked quite a bit, and, you know, I've got to say, you've really, you know, like we were talking about earlier, you kind of first started breaking onto the scene just as recently as like last June, right?
Right.
And,
that's when I started, that's when the first book came out, June 30th. So soon after that, or right around that time, I can't really recall, I started doing, podcasts and, shows and stuff.
Yeah. And I've got to say, man, I've never, you sent me that list of all the shows that you have done and all the shows that you are booked for this month,
very impressive. You're really busting out on the scene here. So it's cool to have you on, and and get to know you while you're coming up here. So, and you know, like we just discussed, I mean, we could go in all kinds of different directions here. But how about this? Let's start here. What exactly do you mean by DMT monitoring?
Okay, so to understand what DMT monitoring is, you have to understand what DMT is. It's a chemical that's produced by your pineal gland. And what it is, it's released in heavy flow into your brain when you're in REM sleep. And then again, it's introduced into your brain in heavy flow right before you die. So it's only at these two points that DMT floods your brain. Now, it's externally, it's a potent psychedelic, but it only lasts for a very short time, and it's very difficult to remember. So what they've done, and what they've recently done, I should take a sidestep real quick. What they've recently done is they've taken a group of three people in Japan, separated them into three separate rooms, hooked them up to Neuralink or some form of Neuralink. And then what they did is they had them playing Tetris together, just using their mind. The three of them played a game of Tetris. So they recently did that. As far as DMT monitoring goes, it's basically like they would hook you up to a monitor, and they basically drip DMT into you at a slow and consistent rate to keep you under, or to keep you in an altered state, and then they're able to monitor you, and you're able to tell them what you see and what you do, and it's everything is recorded. Which is a lot better, because DMT usually in its natural setting is only potent, or it's only available for a very short time. But in this case, it's available for a lot longer.
Right. And, you know, I've also heard that, like, if you have a very synchronistic experience, you know, like, you know, let's say you just randomly thought of a friend that you haven't even thought of in like 5 years. And then right after you get done thinking about them, all of a sudden you get a Facebook message from them or something, you know, like a, you know, a synchronicity. And when you have a lot of times when you have those sorts of experiences, you get that chill that goes down your spine, right? And I've heard that that is actually due to a release of DMT as well. Have you heard of that? Or
no, DMT is more of a hallucinogen, to be honest with you. What it is it's the active compound that allows you to dream in your brain. When you're in heavy REM sleep and you're dreaming, it's because your brain is flooding DMT. I've never heard of that before. I don't think DMT floods your system while you're in your wake cycle, unless you take it artificially.
Okay. Oh, well, yeah. Okay. Yeah, this is something I've heard. And, you know, I also heard that, you know, I think, I'm sure you know Graham Hancock, right?
Oh, yeah. Fingerprints of the Gods, all that stuff.
Oh, yeah. He's one of my favorite people ever. And he was talking recently about, man, I can't remember the name of the actual university. I think it's one of those prestigious universities over there in England. They're quite literally, how do you explain this? They are sending, you know, they're giving subjects DMT experiences, and their mission during the experience is to try to
quite literally map out wherever that place is that people seem to go during those experiences. And I'm sure you've heard, you know, a lot of people experience the same thing.
I think they use fMRIs is what they do.
Oh, okay. Wait, can you say that again?
They use the fMRI. It's a functional magnetic resonating image. What it is you ever see somebody when they introduce like some sort of glucose to the brain and then they'll play music and they'll see what parts light up?
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
It's the same thing. That's what this is.
Okay. Okay.
You know, Sam Harris does a lot of this work.
Right. Yeah. And, yeah, I think it's really fascinating. Cause you know, psychedelics tend to, you know, quite often have a little bit of a stigma to them, right? But
I was created by the government in the 60s.
Exactly. Well said. What
John Lennon actually said. John Lennon said they created acid to control us, and instead it set us free.
Right. And yeah, and I think now that the scientific community is opened up a little bit to the potential benefits of such, you know, whether it's ayahuasca or DMT or what have you.
It's more than that. It's psychedelic mushrooms is being used when you microdose them. They're being used to treat depression. So is LSD. They have ketamine nasal sprays to calm you down now. It's incredible. It's getting legalized. Mushrooms, marijuana is getting legalized everywhere.
Yeah, and it's high time for that to happen, you know. And I thought it was really interesting that of all places, well, let's put it this way. If anybody needs a good psychedelic experience, it's those folks over there in Washington, D.C. And, of course, they just decriminalized psilocybin over there. So, right. What a great start.
Yeah.
And then, of course, you've got what's going on in Oregon. And then, you know, Colorado's well on their way as well. And California was looking good for a minute there. That was going to be in the ballot, but now with everything happening in California right now, that's probably, you know, more on the back burner compared to everything else they're dealing with now. But it is really good to see that, you know, again, not to bring up Mr. Hancock again, but there does seem to be some sort of war on consciousness.
Mm-hmm.
And why do you think this war is happening?
It's basically the elites are trying to suppress consciousness, things that enhance your consciousness. So they'll do things like legalize alcohol. Alcohol comes from the word al-kul, which is it's a Muslim word, actually, and it means body-eating spirit. That's why they're called spirits. Drinks are called spirits. And that's why it's called booze, because it's boo from the ghost. They allow these lower functioning, because it lowers your consciousness. But then they ban everything like marijuana. They call it a class one. It's not a class one. You know, and then They basically keep you away from basically reaching your ascending your chakras and becoming like your own god is what it is. You know, this ancient knowledge that they know, stuff that I'm trying to expose in my books, and I do in my lectures too, showing that, you know, the Bible is just so much more than that.
Oh yeah, and that's a whole. You know what? That's a good segue. Let's go in that direction when we come back. But we do have to take our first break right this very now. So, ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to
to Shift Happens Here for the Fringe FM. I'm your host, Gigi, along with our associate producer, Brad Harris. He's there somewhere, folks, I promise you. And we're also joined by Russ Bailey, our co-host for the evening. I guarantee you he's there, too. And we'll be back here.
I am there.
There you are. And we'll be back in just a few short, minutely minutes. Don't go anywhere. And we're not very good with our health regimen until it's too late. We don't put oil in the car until the engine blows up. When the body's out of balance, your health is not so good. Give your body some love. Log on to GetTheTea.com. That's GetTheTea.com. Try our Life Change Tea, which cleanses you from harmful intruders. A clean colon is one of the ways to bring the body in balance. We also carry organic supplements to help you get where you need to go. So do your body a favor. Log on to GetTheTea.com. That's GetTheTea.com. You can even visit our sales page to save some dough. Does anybody call money dough anymore? Anyway, if you're looking for short, helpful health tips, go to YouTube and punch in Health Matters Now. That's Health Matters Now. So, log on to GetTheTea.com, shop, get balanced, then learn some cool tips at Health Matters Now. You'll be glad you did. That's GetTheTea.com.
From birth, we have been conditioned to conform to what is normal, conditioned to adhere to authority, and conditioned to repeat what has been told to us as truth. I'm Ryan Gable, and here at The Secret Teachings Radio, I've interviewed hundreds of great guests and done extensive unique research into subjects that span from the paranormal and the occult to health, philosophy, and history. I personally have no affiliations or agenda, except to use objective critical thinking in my analysis of every subject discussed, to empower myself with information, and hopefully allow you to do the same. If you want to join me, tune into the Secret Teachings radio broadcast, airing live Monday through Friday from midnight to 3 a.m., U.S. Pacific Standard Time on The Fringe FM. For more information, you can visit our website at www.thesecretteachings.info or email me at rdgable@yahoo.com.
Pure Health Defenders, proud sponsor of Shift Happens, producing organic and natural health, wellness, and technology products for people, pets, and plants to thrive alive. Pure Health Defenders, also known as PHD, is powered by C7 Technology, Scalar Energy, Atomic Technology, and fueled by Sea Miracle Superfoods, 118 nutrients of the purest sea vegetables Mother Earth has to offer. Recognized 100% by people, pets, and plants, delivering the value the same. Everybody deserves a PhD. Be smart about it. Come join the healthiest family today.
Kids, don't drink in park. Accidents cause people. This has been a PSA brought to you by your friends at Shift Happens and The Fringe FM.
Ew, yuck, they're unhealthy and gross. Bugs, I hate bugs. We keep a clean home, but occasionally bugs show up. Well, I found something that is tougher than bugs. Orange Guard. From contact, it kills bugs. Plus, Orange Guard kills hidden bugs and keeps new bugs away for weeks. I know. I use Orange Guard. Plus, all of the ingredients of Orange Guard are on the FDA generally regarded as safe list. Orange Guard may be used around food, humans, and pets. It promotes a healthier planet, and here's a bonus. Orange Guard cleans where it's sprayed. Plus, it comes with a 30-day money-back guarantee. Orange Guard.
you can get Orange Guard at Ace Hardware. And listen, folks, Orange Guard is tougher than bugs, and it's safe to use. Go to orangeguard.com. That's orangeguard.com.
KTLK Digital Broadcasting. We rock the paranormal talk.
Fringe FM, this is Shift Happens. I'm your host, Gigi, along with our associate producer, Brad Harris.
That would be me. Thank you very much.
That would be you. And we're also joined by Russ Bailey from Beyond the Strange. Thanks for hanging
Greetings,
out with us.
Earthlings.
Right on. And our guest tonight is Micah Dank. And now, so we've only got a little bit of time left for you here, so let's go ahead and jump right in. So, so some of the more main these last 6 books that you've been working on, talking about astrotheology, astronomy, the zodiac, and I'm more interested in. Well, all of those, honestly. But also you mention the Bible and how the Bible is an encoded astrology book. Now, before we get into that, are you talking about the current version of the Bible, or do any of the lost gospels come into play here?
So I've decoded like the Book of Enoch, the Book of Matthew, the Book of Revelation with astrotheology. The Book of Enoch is not in our Bible. It was removed, I believe, in 1684. But it's still in the Ethiopian Bible, believe it or not. And, so it works with all Gospels, all Gnostic texts.
Right, and so what do you think about the, just kind of an aside here, what do you think about the Gospel of Thomas? Because that's a pretty interesting, it's a very much Eastern philosophy sort of a bunch of statements that are made there.
It is. It was made prevalent in a movie called Stigmata, which came out about 25 years ago. I don't know if you're familiar with the movie. The phrase by Jesus where he says, you know, you don't have to go to church, split a piece of wood, I'm there, lift a rock and you'll find me. It's talking about seeking yourselves. It goes back to the Egyptians, who used to say the same thing too. They used to say the kingdom of God is within you well before it was said in the Bible. So there's a lot of hidden information in the Bible. If you don't take it literally, that's the thing.
Right. But a lot of people do.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, it was never meant to be taken literally. During the Council of Nicaea in 325, when Constantine united everything, before then, the Christians used to be called Heliognostics, which means, if you break it down, that's Helio, that's the sun, and Gnosis, which means knowing, sun knowers. So they were sun worshippers. Julian the Apostate, who was the nephew of Constantine, when Constantine died, he tried to bring everyone back to sun worship. And he ended up getting killed in battle by someone on his own side.
Right. And so, out of all of your research, you know, as you say here, you make a good case as to who is covertly hiding this encoded information within the Bible and perhaps the lost Gospels as well from us. Who are these people and why? Why are they hiding this?
So why they would do that is because it's supposed to be hidden knowledge. This information was never supposed to get out to the public. The only reason that the Bible got out to everybody was because people became more literate when the printing press came out, when the Gutenberg press came out in the 1500s, and the Bible was able to be mass-produced. So you have that. But the people who are telling you that, I can read you the Roman Catechism. Are you familiar with the Roman Catechisms?
I guess not.
So they're basically like the... They're like addendums to the Bible. It's like, oh, and do this, and do this, and do this. Roman Catechism 2116 says, all forms of divination are rejected, recourse to Satan or demons, conjuring up the dead, or other practices falsely supposed to unveil the future. Consulting horoscopes, astrology, palm readings, interpretation of omens and lots, the phenomena of clairvoyance and recourse to mediums all conceal a desire for power over time, history, and in the last analysis, other human beings, as well as a wish to conciliate hidden powers. They contradict the honor, respect, and loving fear that we owe to God alone. So the church is telling you there's nothing to look here and that astrology is evil. Meanwhile, the book is completely astrology.
Right, yeah, and... Yeah, I mean... And so what do you think about, I mean, let's put it this, in my opinion, at least from what I gather, all the major religions around the world, you know, Buddhism, Islam, Hinduism, you know, Christianity, and of course there's, literally hundreds, if not thousands, of other lesser-known religions. But would you agree that all of these different religions are trying, and more specifically, their ancient texts are trying to describe the same thing? They're talking about the same God, they're talking about the same universal love energy, they just have a different cultural frame of reference that they come from, so it seems like they're talking about different things. But I mean, am I wrong in saying that, or do you think there's any merit
right.
They
to all, that? The religions themselves, no. But the people who follow the religions, they all mean well and they look for deeper meaning. But they're not going to find it by reading their text literally. You know, all the major religious leaders or messiahs or saviors or whatever you want to call them all said the same thing. They said, look inward to find peace. Look inward to find God. They all shared similar messages that if you come across, you could find when you study the different religions.
Right. And there's just been so many. Well, obviously, I mean, throughout history, all kinds of wars and crusades and what have you have been started and fought under the name of either their god or this god or that god. And it almost seems kind of not ironic, but I feel like if we just all sat down and had a little more of a conversation instead of blowing each other up, I think we would find that we all more or less want the same thing. You know, we all want to be happy. We want to have love in life, and we all want friends, and we want our friends to be happy. And
well, the major religions, the people of the major religions, they all believe in the same God. It's just the messenger that they fight over.
Good point. Yeah. Good point. So, do you... Yeah, I wonder if... I mean, do you think there's a more sinister reason why followers of these different religions have been more or less pit against each other? Or do you think it's just...
Well, I go into it in my books. Basically, one of the major world religions created another one, and I expose that in the books.
And speaking of which, where can people find your books?
So I'm on Amazon, but I'm on Twitter and Facebook too at Micah Dank. So I sell signed copies of my books. So if you're interested, you know, just reach out to me on Facebook or Twitter, and we could set something up, and I'll mail you some signed copies of my books.
Oh, yeah, that'd be great. That'd be great. And, yeah, maybe we could give some of those out. Now, also, again, we have a few minutes here. I want to try to cover as much as possible. So let me completely switch gears here, and you know, because I mean, your resume here is quite incredible. You've studied so many different topics, and I would love to get into all of them, but obviously, you know, we don't have time. But one thing I do want to get your opinion on is the pyramids of Egypt. How old are they? Who built them, and how?
I don't know who built them. I do know what they were used for, what they were built for, and I exposed that in my second book. Long story short, they were light centers. They were, and it goes to the missing capstones, because without the capstones, they don't function properly. But with the capstones on, they're basically they transmit energy.
Right, and just like Christopher Dunn, I don't know if you know him. He wrote that book, The Giza Power Plant, and he had a follow up book as well. And yeah, he gets along that same point. But I'm wondering what. What is it about those capstones, or let me rephrase, what were those capstones made out of?
There's theories on it. Some say it was all black, some say it was all gold. It was made out of gold. Some say it was all black. It's really kind of muddled. It's up in the air. No one can really say for sure. All they know is that at some point they were removed and scattered. And that's what my second book is about, is my characters trying to code where they've been scattered to.
Yeah, and Well, one of the common explanations is, you know, over the thousands of years, people have, you know, chipped those outer layers of the pyramids out to build other structures, and which is incredibly short-sighted. I can't believe somebody would come across somebody something so amazing and decide, oh, this is cool, but I want to build a go-kart, so I'm gonna you know,
really exactly what I think people do is they knock down things that we're not ready for yet.
Yeah.
Look what they did to Tesla.
Yeah. And yeah. And I wonder, so I would you say that, I mean, do you think that the evolution and more particular the technological advancement of humans, do you think it's a linear thing from point A to point B, or do you think that this has happened in cycles and perhaps this is not the first time that humans have achieved any sort of technological...
Yeah, that's it. You can go back to Atlantis. It was a city of crystals. It was powered off of crystals. And they show you that in the movie Superman. They show you the Cave of Crystals. In my first book, I talk about it. There's it's crystal technology. It's the ability to embed things into it. They recently, maybe 5-10 years ago, they uploaded a movie into a crystal and then extracted it and played it. You know, crystals have way, way more memory than a regular computer are. They're going to be the future of the hard drives. And we've already been there before with Atlantis. See, we're not by any stretch of the imagination the most technologically advanced civilization that has been on the planet.
Yeah. Yeah, in fact, I think it's quite arguable that we're not. You know, you look at whether it's Machu Picchu or Lebanon or Sacsayhuaman or, you know, the Egypt, Göbekli Tepe, right? You know, a lot of these sites, we can't even, you know, like the great Giorgio Tsoukalo says, there's no way they built this with chicken bones and dental floss. You know?
Yeah.
They obviously, because we like to think of our current cycle of humanity, the only technology that we know is silicon electronic based, right?
Right.
But who's to say that there was, that there's not all kinds of other lines of technological advancement that previous cycles of humanity might have discovered first before they found, if ever.
Yes, absolutely. I agree with that 100%.
Yeah. And and so here's really, again, we only have a few minutes here. Here's the ultimate question. Somebody somewhere, some people on this planet, whether it's a three-letter agency or what have you, somebody knows that we are being lied to about the history of humanity. They keep, you know, we're taught in school that the Sumerians were the first civilization, but then now we have Göbekli Tepe, and now we have Gudang-Padang, which clearly indicate that civilization has been around for quite some time. And not to even get into, I mean, not to mention Michael Kremer's work, you know, some of his discoveries that show human technology dating back, in one case, I believe, 800 million years. And so just assuming that this is all true, what is in their best benefit? And by their, I mean, you know, the infamous quote, they, whoever they are, right?
Right.
Why hide our history from us? I mean, because I still have to pay my cell phone bill tomorrow, you know? So what does it matter if I know how old the pyramids are or not?
Well, because the major religions run off of three books that tell you the world is 6,000 to 8,000 years old. Okay? And everything has to fit. Every time they find an archaeological difference in Egypt that goes against that, they bury it. They hide it.
But why?
Because it keeps you at a lower consciousness. You believe the earth is 6,000 years old and everything is taken literally, like the Bible or the Old Testament or the New Testament or the Quran. It keeps you at a low. It's a control mechanism.
Yes, it certainly is. I just don't understand the need for such control. I mean,
because there's people out there who've started this whole thing that don't want to give up their power.
Right.
Yeah. Well, I've got a question.
Yeah, go ahead.
Their civilizations, you know, they had this high technology, but my question is, what happened to it? Did we just get a big reset or what?
What happened is, about 12,000 years ago, there was an ice age. So things got completely lost. The only thing that were saved were massive structures like pyramids and the Sphinx. And the Sphinx was barely found to begin with. You see how massive it is.
Right.
So this stuff, everything was frozen. We go through cyclical periods of ice ages.
So do you think that ice age could have been caused by like an ancient nuclear war?
I mean, I guess anything is possible, but I personally don't think that is. I think it's just we find that history goes through ice ages, because what happened is after the ice age, everything melted, and that's where all the modern civilizations going 3,000 years back get their flood stories from. It's because everything melted.
So I wonder if, I mean, I'm not sure if you've been following what's been happening in Texas, but I guess in a sense you could say they just went through a little ice age of their own these last couple of weeks. Do you think in not only there, but all across the country, there's been crazy historical weather that hasn't been seen in 70 or 80 years.
Right.
Do you think this is... Well, let's just stick with Texas right now. Do you think that this is just a random fluke of bad luck and weather? Or do you think it's going to continue to get worse and worse every year as we keep going?
It's a cyclical pattern. Is what happens. I think the last time this happened was 120 years ago, where everything just froze. But it's a mini Earth event. It's not a global just freeze.
Right. So, do you think Texas could? Do you think Texas should expect a similar situation that they're facing right now at this time next year? Or do you...
No, not going to happen next year.
Oh, really?
I mean, even the Sahara Desert gets snow every few years. I mean, not every few years, but every once in a while.
Right. Yeah. And, it's just, crazy times. I think we're really... These are historical times, and man, I just can't wait to see. Well, I'll be dead by then, but I really wonder what the history books are going to say 200 years from now about what's happening now. You know?
Right.
And then, of course, you know, this, there's all kinds of theory, you know,
you know, some people think it's natural, and then you can go down the whole geoengineering path, and you know, some people think this is some sort of contrived situation. So, very last question. What do you think what's happening right now is purely natural, or do you think that some of the new technology that humans have developed, especially these last few years, whether it's DARPA or NASA or what have you, do you think our new technological developments are having any effect on the current weather situations that...
Well, it's possible. I mean, there's always a trade-off. You have to understand is that we gain something from, like, the Industrial Revolution. You know, we gained all that, and then we gained pollution, you know, sky pollution. Used to be able to see the stars perfectly. Now you can't do that anymore. There's a trade-off for everything. You know, you have electric cars, but then you have to dig up half the world to get the lithium and the cobalt. You know, there's a trade-off.
Yeah. And, oh, man. You know what? We have to take our next break, and I know it's late over there, and I appreciate you for coming on for as long as you could. But yeah, we'll go ahead and let you go. But before we do, let's let everyone know where they can keep up with you and all of your research and follow everything that is Micah Dank.
I'm on Twitter and Facebook at Micah Dank. My book series Into the Rabbit Hole is on Amazon. And it's a 6-book series. They're thrillers. They're like Dan Brown thrillers. They're truth and fiction is what I've written.
Oh, it's, perfect.
They're like Da Vinci Code. They're like Angels and Demons. They're those type of books.
Yeah, and I think I would imagine you might agree that sometimes the best way to explain very real truths is through means of fiction, if you know what I mean.
Look at like 1984.
Exactly. Right. Yeah. So, man, we have so much more to talk about here, but, you know, like I said, it's lay over there, so I'll go ahead and let you go. But yeah, let's definitely do a part two sometime, whether on here or on the other shows. And I've just got so many more questions to pick your brain with.
Yeah, absolutely. Reach out to me.
Absolutely. All right, man. Well, listen, you have a great rest of your night. Thanks again for coming on the show tonight. And we'll talk to you hopefully soon.
All right. Sounds good. Take care, guys. Thanks for having me on.
All right. You too. Cheers to you.
Yep.
All right. And with that, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take our next commercial break. And we'll be back here in just a few short minutes. Don't go anywhere. Tired of talking about the weather? No shift. Well, Shift Happens is here to fulfill your desires. As you reach that point,
point in life where you crave tantalizing conversation about reality, ufology, the occult, and the conspiracies within, while simultaneously finding yourself desperately in need of your very own theme music, which we've got plenty of that too. So be sure to tune in to Shift Happens every Friday night from 7 to 9 Pacific, right here on The Fringe FM. Because the weather sucks, and you need some theme music.
Ever seen an extraterrestrial? It can be hard to believe they exist unless you've seen one for yourself. What if I told you I've seen them my whole life, but have never had a witness who shared the encounter with me? Now, what if I told you I saw four of them, two with blue skin, and there are over 20 witnesses to this CE5 event? My new book, The Blue Beings, Visitation at the UFO Conference, documents actual accounts from real witnesses, many of which have gone on record to attest to this otherworldly reality. Be a part of the quantum paradigm shift that is taking place right now. Go to johnpolkmedia.com to get your copy of The Blue Beings, Visitation at the UFO Conference, on sale right now at johnpolkmedia.com. That's johnpolkmedia.com.
This is Ronnie LeBlanc, author of Monsterland, Encounters with UFOs, Bigfoot, and Orange Orbs, and you're listening to Shift Happens on KTLK, The Fringe FM.
KTLK Digital Broadcast. We rock the paranormal talk.
And we're back with the French FM. This is Shift Happens. I'm your host, G.J. Walthar, associate producer, Brad Harris.
I'm just here for the music, man.
Yeah, I think a lot of us are. And
Mr. Dank, he was pretty awesome.
Yeah, man, I wish, we had more time, but, you know, he's on the East Coast, and it's quite late over there, so... but yeah, we'll definitely talk to him again sooner than later. And again, we're also joined by Russ Bailey from Beyond the Strange. What's happening, my friend?
What's up, folks? Thanks for joining us this evening.
Yeah, for sure. So I guess for the rest of the night, why not? Why don't we go ahead and open up the phone lines? If I can do so, let's see. We've already had some technical problems tonight. Let's hope that this won't be one. Oh boy. Really? Okay, hold on. Oh, here we go. Okay, so phone lines are open. If you want to call in, call in number is 1-800-588-0335. Again, that's 1-800-588-0335. Feel free to call in if you have a quick comment or a question, or if you want to hang out for a while, whatever you want to do. So, but anyways, with that, yeah, I just, man, I wish we could have had Micah on the show for longer, because, man, with his whole track record and all the books he's written and all the research he's done, I have so many questions. But, again, you know, we'll have to save that for another time. So, but in the meantime, I would like to mention that Dave Cruz did a really good show the other day, along with Russ. Well, that was yesterday. And we had Jeff Rennell on the show, and I was also a part of it. And, man, that was a really cool conversation. I mean, the whole thing was a really cool conversation. So if you guys happen to miss that, you can go, is that on Twitch or is that on Spreaker, Russ?
Yeah, it's you can follow that, see that show on Twitch. It's twitch.tv/beyondthestrange.
There you go. Yeah, definitely check that out. That was a really good conversation there.
Excellent. Very uplifting show last night.
Absolutely. And yeah, and speaking of which, you know, so while I was updating the website and making the promos for tonight's show and all that stuff, I decided to play Russ, your whole team's Black Sky Paranormal, that episode you did at that hotel. And right. Man, I'm really fascinated by that. And also, I thought it was really funny how, well, I don't know how appropriate that is to see on here, but you, well, you essentially, can I say this? I don't know. Who cares? Let's give it a try. You essentially called out a spirit for having once been a hooker when they were alive.
Yes, and we got responses too.
Yeah, that's the even better part. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, That whole episode is just it's off the charts amazing. I mean, the production quality, I mean,
fantastic.
Yeah, Argos Paranormal. Yeah. If you guys haven't watched The Witching Hour yet, you are really missing out. You need to go over to argosparanormal.com and to their YouTube page to catch episodes of The Witching Hour. Ryan Remzo Martinez, Brian Sajanin, they do some awesome work, man.
So, do you think that, I mean, because the term ghost is kind of a vague term. I mean, it could be, I mean, what's to say that what we call a ghost and these ghost activities that you guys put a lot of time and money and energy into researching, what's to, like, are you sure that they're spirits of humans that used to live here? Or is there a chance that those might be some sort of extra-dimensional beings?
Well, it's really hard to say. There's no real science to it, I don't think. You know, it could be ghosts, could be demons. It could be communications from other dimensions. They could even be a lot of... One of my theories is that some of the paranormal activity that you encounter in these so-called haunted houses, hotels, whatever, I think it could be aliens, because they could, extraterrestrials could easily cloak their ships. Why can't they cloak themselves and walk around with us and communicate with us on different frequencies and consciousness? That's always been a theory of mine.
Yeah, and that's, I mean, that very well could be too, right?
Yeah.
And I know, sometimes I just wonder, how do I say this? I think humans have a tendency to, well, I'm talking about humans as if I'm not one, but humans tend to have, they tend to believe that any sort of paranormal, ghost slash potentially extra dimensional beings or whatever, we tend to believe that they are former humans, right? But right. I feel like we might be a little bit biased on that assumption. Would you, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, because that's, to me, that's the easy way out. What a lot of people don't realize is that when you go into these places and you're communicating, you're opening yourself up, you know, if it's an evil entity, it could be lying to you, posing as a little girl, spirit of a little girl, when it's actually a demon or something to that nature. So, again, we don't really know what is we're communicating with. I do know that you have to exercise caution on everything, and you can't get too deep into the investigations because you run a risk of having an attachment attach itself to you, and then that's a whole nother ball game trying to get rid of that.
Right. And well, before we go any further, so Dan actually explained what Dan James, all the way out there from the great land of Oz,
yeah,
just basically said what way better what I was trying to say.
And he says, the term ghost seems to be a broad generalization for any unexplained, singular, unseen entity. I think that's, you know, that's what I meant. You know, so, yeah. Like, is there any real way for us to tell the difference? I mean, or is there?
I mean, the one reason we try to decipher what we're actually communicating with is before we go into a place to investigate a location, we try to look up all the information about it and try to educate ourselves on the history of the place and everything like that. And we talk to people, you know, that's previous investigators or people that had experiences there, and try to figure out and pinpoint what exactly it is we are dealing with. Different locations, we have different encounters. I mean, like at Lake Shawnee, I did an investigation there by myself. None of my team was with me that night. And we were on a ghost tour with another group, and there was a one of the tour guides was a psychic medium, and she pretty much said that the spirit was her, this one girl's grandmother, and was talking with her, telling her she was okay and everything. So, I mean, you have psychic encounters, you'll have demonic encounters, you'll have spirits, ghosts. I mean, it's unbelievable what you can run into, and there's always something different with each location, it seems.
Right, and speaking of which, Mike Jordan in the chat room just said it's all about location, location, location.
Yes, I agree. And I will say something else, Gigi, that I've noticed on a lot of my investigations is the energy and the activity seems to ramp up because a lot of these places are close to bodies of flowing water. Trans-Allegheny Lunatic Asylum is right next to a river. Old South Pittsburgh Hospital in Tennessee, close to a river and a dam. You know, all these places. I mean, St. Albans Sanatorium, river runs right by it. So there's got to be a key to the flowing energy of water and maybe limestone, possibly, because a lot of these older buildings are made of limestone. So it's a combination of that, those substances, I think, that really amplifies the energy and the paranormal activity.
Yeah, well, especially limestone, right? Because, I mean, Courtney, I mean, doesn't limestone have quite literally quartz crystals all throughout it, right?
Right, and who's to say that maybe these extraterrestrials are even attracted to these quartz crystals for some reason, and they're cloaking themselves to walk among us, so to speak. I mean, it's definitely plausible, in my opinion.
Yeah, and I mean, yeah, it kind of, that could be, right? Mm-hmm. But also, aliens could be here just because, you know, just to make some sort of, what's the word, analogy. You know, if, I mean, just like we do, just like humans do, we observe other species and we watch what they do. I mean, just a couple of years ago, we found a couple of orangutans that learned how to spearfish all on their own, you know?
Right.
And some people would tell you that they have actually, by all definitions, have entered the Stone Age with their species. They have learned how to make tools and use them efficiently. You know?
Right.
Mm-hmm. So, but with that said, just in the same way that, you know, for example, the split second that, you know, scientists found out that they figured out how to do that, well, what did they do? They took them out of their environment and they analyzed them and studied them and locked them in a cage and all that kind of stuff. And so who's to say what, like, because, I mean, let's face it, humans were pretty stupid for several hundred thousand years. It wasn't until the last, you know, well, depends on who you ask. What you're taught in school is Sumerians, right? 5,000 BC, that was the first ones, right? But then we found, you know, Göbekli Tepe, which is 12,000, and then Gudang Padang, which is anywhere from 20 to 30,000. So what's to say that, especially back in the 1940s, once humans started detonating nuclear bombs, if I were an alien race, I would probably jump in and be like, hey, let's stop this. You know?
Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, before we destroy ourselves.
Yeah. Well, honestly, I'm not sure if they're too concerned about ourselves. I think they're more concerned about the planet.
Yeah.
And, you know, one of my random theories that is, I'm sure, not many people agree with is I have a little bit of a suspicion that at least some of these ETs aren't coming from very far away. In fact, I don't think they're coming from anywhere. I think they live right here. And I mean, think about it. We haven't even explored 5% of the ocean. We have no, and no one has ever drilled more than, what was it, 12 miles? I think Russia at one point had a huge mission to get as far as they could, and they couldn't get past 12 miles. Well, guess what? There's hundreds of more miles beyond those 12 miles. So who's to say? And then, of course, you find these underground cavern cities, right? Like, for example, the one, I'm not sure how many people are aware of this, but there was a whole underground, not just a tunnel, but an underground civilization. Like, there's, you know, living chambers, there's ritual chambers, there's these kind of, you know, like, and those chambers go all the way from Turkey to the UK. And those were built way before the Sumerians, not to mention way before the Ice Age, not to mention way before Gudang Padang. So wait a minute. Who built that?
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, there's been sightings of unidentified submerged objects, even underground bases. And, you know, I think once we get back from the break, I think that's a good place to speculate what's going on there and everything.
Yeah, absolutely. And speaking of which, yeah, we should probably go ahead and take our next break, our last and final break. And yeah, let's just do that now. All right. Ladies and gentlemen,
You're listening to Shift Happens here for the Fringe FM. I'm your host, Gigi Almothar, associate producer Brad Harris.
Aliens Underground after the break.
Oh boy, yeah, let's get into it. And we're also joined by Russ Bailey from Beyond the Strange, and we'll be back here in just a few short minutes. Don't go anywhere.
Are you thinking about creating a podcast but don't know where to start? Do you really want to have to learn all this stuff?
Individual track processing, enhance and improve sound quality, edit out those awkward pauses and slips, mix multiple clips and tracks, fix and balance noise levels and perfect volumes, deliver consistent sound. Live podcast production, show notes and SEO optimization, episode upload to hosting, live call screening, balance levels allowed to measure broadcast standards, full branding packages, logo design, podcast site, website, show artwork, video and audio production, gotta do video because everybody's doing video, branded video graphics.
Or do you just want to get on the mic and get your ideas out there? The Fringe FM team is here to help with all of your podcasting, audio and video production needs. From simple podcast to audio enhancement, our professional production staff will make it easier than ever to create the podcast you desire.
The biggest thing is time. A lot of people that podcast don't have time. Time is like a really valuable currency next to cost. It's even more important than money. Why waste your time doing all this stuff? This is what we can do for you. Think about like the hours and the money you're gonna have to put into doing all this by yourself. Doesn't make sense. It's gonna take you months to launch. If we did it for you, we could do it tomorrow.
Visit thefringe.fm, join our team, and get jump started on your podcast today.
Everything is awesome. Everything is cool when you're part of a team.
Are you intrigued by Paranormal Talk Radio? You'll love the new Paranormal Radio app from TalkStream Live. You'll find a great selection of talk shows covering UFOs, ghosts, strange phenomena, and much more. Download the Paranormal Radio app now and start listening to the very best in paranormal talk entertainment, including the network you're listening to right now, the Paranormal Radio app, free in Google Play and the iOS App Store.
This is Jess Rogie, host of The Rogie Report, and you're listening to The Fringe FM, KTLK, Digital Broadcasting.
Hi, folks. These uncertain times can cause uncertain gut slowdown. Worry and fear can wreak havoc on our digestion, making it hard to feel optimum. Bloating, less energy, and occasional constipation can slow you down in your daily activity. Try Life Change Tea at getthetea.com. Life Change Tea can help get things moving so you can get that boost of energy you need. Life Change Tea helps protect and defend your health from intruders. It's a weird time right now with all the uncertainty, so gear up and defend your health. Where do you go to purchase? Log on to getthetea.com. That's getthetea.com. The specials are on the front page, and we have numerous supplements to help combat intruders. It's time to take charge of our health and to feel better in life. It's time to live. Again, getthetea.com. That's getthetea.com. Getthetea.com. It is so worth it. Getthetea.com.
I'm Dave Cruz of Beyond the Strange. You're listening to KTLK Digital Broadcasting. This is The Fringe FM.
Hey, is that a new music app?
Yeah, check it out. Surfer Music Discovery. It links to thousands of online stations, but the twist is you see the song names and artists that are now playing live.
That's different. No guessing. Looks like a waterfall of music.
So many formats. Rock, oldies, country, R&B, jazz, and a whole lot more.
How's that spelled?
Surfer. S-U-R-F-R.
Is it expensive?
It's free. No need to sign up or sign in.
Get the Surfer Music app free from Google Play or the App Store.
Hey, Fringe listeners, Dave Cruz here, reminding you that Beyond the Strange airs live Monday evenings at 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, 10 p.m. Eastern Time, right here on The Fringe FM. BTS is your one-stop shop for the paranormal, the bizarre, and most of all, the strange. Join me and co-host Black Sky Paranormal's Russ Bailey as we discuss topics such as aliens, ghosts, Bigfoot, and much more. Also, we talk with profound guests, authors, researchers from all over the world, and we take your calls live on the air. Go to beyondthestrange.com and learn more about the show, guests, times, free registration for our newsletter, merch, and much more. Again, that's Beyond the Strange, Monday evenings, 7 p.m. Pacific, 10 p.m. Eastern, right here on KTLK Digital Broadcasting, The Fringe FM. And as always, stay strange.
KTLK Digital Broadcasting. We rock the paranormal talk.
This is Tom Sherman. Down here at Banning College, we're up. We're promoting a blood drop.
Oh, shit.
Not guilty.
Welcome to the Sound of America. You're listening to AM 580. Lay back. The sheep. Little lamb. Little lamb. Little lamb. Little lamb. Little lamb. Little lamb.
Eve sold Adam the apple.
Don't throw me so to my face!
You cannot be saved.
Follow me in our...
Good to know that he's walking with me.
Big rock as a weapon.
The devil is a black dog.
Into the fog.
Let him cast the first stone.
Jesus, Jesus.
And you have fallen into the love that needs to be designed by the Lord. Hallelujah, y'all. I want to hear a couple of hallelujahs.
Life's a study of dying. How to do it right. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Shift Happens here for the Fringe FM. I'm your host, Gigi, along with our associate producer, Bradley Harris.
What's up?
Yes. And
hello.
We're also joined by Russ Bailey. Co-host of Beyond the Strange is filling in tonight for JP. Thanks for hanging out with us.
Yo, yo. What's up, people?
Yeah, right on. Now, before we get back to the business, K28 just posted a really... I would like to read his comment on the air and see what you think about this, Russ.
Okay.
So he says that he saw a ghost of a little girl wearing a robe hovering over his wife in bed. The ghost girl was wearing a robe that was flowing like it was blowing in the wind. She was about 2 feet above
his wife horizontally. She was a ghostly, translucent white. And he got out of bed and walked around to his wife's side of the bed. The ghost ignored him, looking at his wife, staring at his sleeping wife. I think I read that wrong. And he waved his hand through her robe and body as if nothing was there.
Whoa.
What do you make of that?
Well, obviously it's some type of residual energy that's left over. One thing I've never been able to understand is these ghosts or apparitions that people see, how do they still have their clothes on? That's because, you know, it's an inanimate object. Unless the clothes are holding some type of energy when there's a trauma passing or whatnot. But very, very chilling story. Another story I've heard of residual energy. My sister was telling me this story. She lives in the Chicagoland area in Illinois. And she had a friend of hers who was a nurse. And the nurse kept seeing this man in a black robe running through her house, like, really fast with, you know, like a long coat and a hat on. One night, you know how some of these in these modern kitchens have these utensils like pots and pans hanging over the island in their kitchen. One night, the pots and pans started going crazy. And, she told my sister, she said, I thought I was going nuts. She said, I called the police. Police came to the house, no breaking signs of breaking and entering or anything like that. And she said, I thought I was going insane. Well, the next day, the nurse's daughter or son was there. And he looked up at his mother and said, Mommy, why does that man in the black coat always run through our house and never look at us and keep darting back and forth and makes noise? She said, I knew right then that's when we had a ghost. Now, she didn't feel anything malicious from it or anything. It was just a residual haunting. So it makes me wonder what's causing that energy to stay behind and form apparitions and everything like that. But, you know, obviously there is some energy to it because it couldn't move the pots and pans and make all the disruption and everything like that.
Right. Well, I guess what I always wonder is in that exact situation, right, mm-hmm. is – do you think it's really, you know, the leftover consciousness or soul or spirit or whatever of somebody that used to be there, and that's what that is? Or maybe is it an some sort of interdimensional being that is putting on that facade to make you think that for some other ulterior motive that we probably have no idea what that motive is?
I mean, that's definitely plausible because the amount of energy it takes to move between dimensions would have to be off the chart. And by it producing that energy, it could produce, you know, disruptions of, you know, inanimate objects and whatnot. That's definitely plausible, I think.
Yeah, I think so, too. That's kind of why I said it. Mm-hmm. But also, real quick, Scott the Rocker says, Gigi, I am with you. These aliens are the fallen ones. They live right here amongst us, which, well, that's more has to do with what I said quite a while back. But
right.
Yeah, honestly, I don't know. I just have a feeling that, I mean, if you look at the Earth, the surface of the Earth is like, what, 1% of what the Earth actually is? Like, and then, you know, like we discussed earlier, you know, there's, whether it's in Peru or Lebanon or the whole tunnel that was built from Turkey all the way to the UK, obviously somebody at some point in time had way better technology and a way better understanding of how to do that. And well, let's think about it this way. What if all of a sudden NASA announced tomorrow, like, hey, if you stay on the surface, you're going to be smoked into ashes because the sun's about to explode, right? Well, right. What would you do? You would build an underground safe haven, right? Well, who's right. to say that didn't happen before, you know? And honestly, there's quite a lot of evidence that it did, but anyway, don't mind me. Don't let me go down too far this track. But well, hold on. Dan James has a comment. I haven't pre-read it, but usually Dan has really great things to say. So let's let's all read this together. He says, if it's taking the same path all the time, I'd put that down to stone tape theory? Wait, I'm sorry. I don't know what that is. Do you?
I want to say it's maybe energy that's been recorded. And it's kind of playing over and over again. I'm not really sure myself.
All right, well, let's assume what that is. So he says, if it's taken the same path at the time, the same path all the time, I'd put that down to stolen tape theory, just an on-loop energy recording absorbed by building and somehow triggered. I'm assuming there was a couple of grammatical errors there because I didn't quite understand that. But usually Dan is pretty more than spot on. So Dan, if you could rephrase that, I'd love to explore that topic. But but yeah, man, I don't know. I think yes, I can already hear. Yeah, I know. I've said a lot tonight. I get it, all right? But like,
and I'm too.
But here's the thing is,
It's Stoner Rock Radio, man. You're supposed to say ah.
Yeah. Well, listen, if I had a quarter for every time Jimmy said I would have about, I don't know, about $878. So there you go.
Plus $37.
Plus 37, yes. Now, but I feel like humanity, and I don't mean to sound negative or anything, but I feel like maybe humanity has sort of reached this point of understanding itself that is not healthy for us to understand. I think maybe we might be better off not asking these questions. Maybe we're better off just cooking a couple of hot dogs, you know, and watching a football game. Maybe we're not meant...
A bacon wrap hot dog.
Well, oh, hopefully yeah, a bacon wrap.
No, you know what? I think maybe it did start... It started for humanity here on Earth, you know, underground. Maybe that's where the jump start was. Because, I mean, there's all different forms of aliens, and we get visited, you know. Dude, I got the alien handbook. There's like, I forget, like 500 different species or something in it. So, yeah, I mean, there's not just one, you know, but for us, I'm sure that underground stuff is very interesting. You know, that's that the Native Indians believe that the ant people, which could be, you know, their interpretation and depiction of, you know, these aliens that were underground, maybe. I don't know.
Yeah, well, they talk about the ant people, you know? Mm-hmm. And you gotta wonder. I mean, as spiritually evolved as Native Americans are, they're talking about ant people that came out from the ground and taught them what they know.
Right.
So, are we just gonna ignore that? Or are we gonna at least take it somewhat seriously and actually at least try to understand what they're saying? You know?
Well, not only that, but, you know, all these underground supposedly alien bases also... You know, Laura Eisenhower even mentions that her great grandpa, General Eisenhower, President Eisenhower, made a deal with extraterrestrials so they could harvest our DNA and abduct us and for exchange for technology. And you know, one of the reasons is because these grays, supposedly, they need our DNA to help reproduce, so they won't go extinct.
Right. Yeah.
Okay, and I've never heard that before. That's pretty interesting.
Yeah, she. It was on UFO Witness a couple of episodes ago on Discovery Plus.
Wow, that's pretty good.
Ben Hansen had actually talked to Laura Eisenhower, and you know, these grays, supposedly, they need our DNA to help, you know, replenish themselves. You know, they even had the finale episode was about hybrids and how they're mixing DNA with our DNA with alien DNA and creating hybrid beings.
Did cattle mutilations come into the conversation?
Well,
no, they didn't.
Well, I mean, not
DNA.
That's not too, you know, not too far off, Brad, but yeah, I, you know, knowing Laura, I'm not sure if, yeah, that's, you know what, how about that, next time we have Laura back here, we'll ask her about that. I think I have a little bit of insight into that, but at the same
you know what I'm saying?
I might not. So
yeah.
So let's just wait until she comes back on. And let's see. All right. So yeah, there's a lot of questions in both of the chat rooms here. But we only have a few minutes, so but anyway, yeah, I think that
what are you doing over there?
Well, I'm trying to think about what I'm gonna say.
Well, I heard this like scratching, like a rat was on your freaking microphone or something.
I was just scratching my microphone. But yeah, I just have a feeling that I know this might not be the most positive thing ever, but I have a feeling that, who knows, maybe us humans are not designed to fully understand why we're here. In fact, it might be the case that if I were to figure out why I was here, that would defeat the whole purpose of being here in the first place. So you would automatically be removed, if right. That makes any sense. I mean, just in the same way, let's say you were to, you know, they do experiments with mice all the time, right? Uh-huh. And you're trying to get them to understand how to navigate their way to the trees in this, or not the trees, the cheese in that maze, right? But
yeah, go with it.
But if you tell them in advance where the cheese already is, well, then that defeats the whole point of the experiment.
Right.
You know what I mean? Does that make any sense?
Makes perfect sense.
So in that same way, maybe we're not, you know,
maybe our cheese isn't ready yet.
Or maybe we're not supposed...
Maybe our cheese is fermenting.
Maybe we're not supposed to know where the cheese is. Maybe that's the whole point of life. You know, is to figure it out on your own. Because if you don't figure it out on your own, then what's the point?
Right.
It's pretty deep, GG.
Yeah, now you got me hungry for cheese.
I know. Some blue cheese. Uh-huh. Yeah.
And you know what? Here comes Scott the Rocker. Agreeing with exactly what I just said, but honestly, it doesn't matter. I'm sure most people don't agree. I'm just saying that might be, that very well might be let's put it this way. I don't think any human being living on Earth is ever going to figure out why we're here. I don't think that's...
I disagree.
Well, I hope I'm wrong. I hope I'm wrong. And I hope you're right. I really do. But... yeah, no, it's... there's... yeah, it's a, you know, it's a strange world, and we have a lot of brilliant minds on this planet, especially right now. You know, we
right.
Humans have never been more brilliant, but yet we still don't understand why we're here. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Now, that's not to say that there is a specific reason that we're here, but you would assume that whoever put us, you know, whether it's God or whether it's a race of ETs or whatever you want to think, somebody put us here for some reason. And I don't think we're even close to figuring out why we're here is kind of my point. Now with that, with that,
time flies.
It does fly, but
time warp.
Luckily, I have a thing queued up here. So, sorry, Scott. I've been seeing your comments there, by the way, buddy. We just don't have enough time here. But I want to leave you guys with a little audio clip from the late, great, and powerful Bill Hicks, if you guys don't mind. So, with that said, we're going to play this clip right here, and then we'll wrap up the show right after this. All right, here we go.
How about a positive LSD story? Wouldn't that be newsworthy just once, to base your decision on information rather than scare tactics and superstitions and lies? I think it would be newsworthy. Today, a young man on acid realized that all matter is merely energy condensed to a slow vibration, that we are all one consciousness experiencing itself subjectively. There is no such thing as death. Life is only a dream, and we're the imagination of ourselves. Here's Tom with the weather. Been fantastic, and I hope you enjoyed it. There is a point. Is there a point to all this? Let's find a point. Is there a point to my act? I would say there is. I have to. The world is like a ride at an amusement park, and when you choose to go on it, you think it's real, because that's how powerful our minds are. And the ride goes up and down and round. It has thrills and chills, and it's very brightly colored, and it's very loud, and it's fun for a while. Some people have been on the ride for a long time, and they begin to question, is this real, or is this just a ride? And other people have remembered, and they come back to us, and they say, hey, don't worry, don't be afraid, ever, because this is just a ride, and we kill those people. Shut him up. We have a lot invested in this ride. Shut him up. Look at my furrows of worry. Look at my big bank account and my family. This has to be real. It's just a ride. But we always kill those good guys who try and tell us that. You ever notice that? And let the demons run amok. But it doesn't matter, because it's just a ride. And we can change it anytime we want. It's only a choice. No effort, no work, no job, no savings of money. A choice right now between fear and love. The eyes of fear want you to put bigger locks on your door, buy guns, close yourself off. The eyes of love instead see all of us as one. Here's what we can do to change the world right now to a better ride. Take all that money we spend on weapons and defense each year and instead spend it feeding, clothing, and educating the poor of the world, which it would many times over, not one human being excluded, and we can explore space together, both inner and outer, forever in peace. Thank you very much. You've been great. I hope you enjoyed it. London, you're fantastic. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Again, the great, powerful, late, great Bill Hicks. And with that, we've got a boogie right the hell on out of here. So, real quick, before we do, me and Brad, obviously, guys never find us. What about you, Russ? Where can they find you?
Facebook, Beyond the Strange. Twitter at BSky _ Paranormal. ArgosParanormal.com and BeyondTheStrange.com.
There you go. And with that, again, I'd like to thank our guest for the first hour, Micah Dank, which I have to say is the coolest last name ever. So, yeah, and with that, we got to beg you folks. So, ladies and gentlemen, this has been Shift Happens for the French FM. This show is hosted and produced by yours truly, GG. You can follow me on Twitter at GGRabbit1. Or more importantly, you can follow the show over at Shift Happens Pod. On Twitter, associate producer is Brad Harris. You can follow him on Twitter at ADS Brad Harris. Isn't that right, Brad?
Yeah, it is. Buy our shirts. Buy some shirts. We got plenty of sizes.
And yes, definitely buy our shirts. That would help a lot. And, of course, as always, Rowing, well, special shout out to Eric Awakening Man for all the roaming reporting that he does. Special thanks to Dennis Koch for all the promotional goodness that he does. And of course, last but certainly not least is Fran. That's right. All blames and faults go to Fran. That's right. Hashtag Fran's fault.
Thank you, Fran.
All right, folks. We are going to do a Shift Happen Sunday. This Sunday. We're still working on what time it's going to be. But, yeah, like we just said, follow us on Twitter and you will stay posted. And with that, coming up next right here is Joe Roop with Lighting the Void on the Fringe FM. And with that, we'll see you next week, folks. Take care.